Our panel is about to start, and thanks for coming tonight. I'm Odette. I'm a junior at Arnold College of Columbia University, and I'm going to be the moderator tonight. We are going to spend a wonderful evening immersing in the collection of East Asian art. First, let me introduce to you the structure of the panel. It will be centered on two different but also highly interconnected topics, which are first, museum collections, including the curatorial philosophy behind exhibition, taste of museum collection. The second one will be private collection, which includes private museum boom and like the more commercial side of the art world. We are honored to have our three ladies join us tonight as the panelists who are the experts in their respective fields. I'm sorry to say that there was another speaker from Guggenheim Museum who was supposed to join us, but she apparently had a medical issue, so she couldn't come. So those three ladies are Miss Adriana Poser, John H. Foster, Curator of Traditional Asian Art at Asia Society Museum, and Prof. Annie Higgonen, and Whitney Olin Professor, Chair of Art History Department at Barnard College, Columbia University. And the lady sits next to me is Ms. Serena Taylor, Associate Specialist of Asian Art, Asian 20th Century and Contemporary Art at Christie's. Could you briefly introduce yourself, like your background and your specialty focus areas to the audience? Maybe start with Ms. Poser.
Sure. Thank you, first of all, for inviting me to this panel. It's a pleasure to be here, and actually, I was really happy to do this because I, in fact, got my PhD in Chinese art history here at Columbia University. And I got my PhD in 1995, and since that time, my first real curatorial job was at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, where I was in the East Asian department for about 7 years. And then after that, I got my position at Asia Society here in New York, and I've been there for almost 15 years now. So I've been there a long time. As I said, my specialist training was really in China and early China in particular. When I was at Philadelphia Museum of Art, I worked with all the East Asian collections, and in fact, the East Asian department there is broader than just, or at that time was broader than just East Asia. It also included works of Islamic art and also some Southeast Asian art. And really that's, if you go into a museum position, often what happens is that all of a sudden you find yourself confronted with material that you were never trained in. At that time, at the time I was here at Columbia studying, I studied Indian art, I studied Japanese art. I had to teach East Asian art Hum at a certain point, so I had to teach myself Korean art because nobody was teaching Korean art then, and there were like two catalogs that you could use. But of course, things have changed. And now at Asia Society, actually, we only have two curators. I'm the curator for so-called traditional Asian art, for lack of a better word. My colleague, Michelle Yuen, is our curator for modern and contemporary art. And even my role in terms of what I cover has changed since I've been at Asia Society, because when I started, I was basically responsible for everything in Asia from the beginning of time to the present, if it was in kind of traditional materials. Anything that was new media, photography, that kind of thing, or non-traditional Asian materials was in the hands of the curator of contemporary art. But now the curator of contemporary art does everything contemporary, including, you know, like Chinese ink paintings in their hands. So one's role kind of shifts and changes as what people's background and what's going on in the culture changes. But in general, I work on all of our exhibitions. I work on exhibitions of my own, and I work a lot with guest curators who are specialists in their various areas.
So I'm Ann Eagerling, as you heard. And I was trained to really know about nothing but basically European painting. Mm-hmm. And to talk about being confronted with things you don't know, as I finished graduate school and became an assistant professor, the whole world began to globalize, and I realized that art history would need to do the same. And for me, the way into that was to become very interested in the history of museums, because collecting is a universal psychological impulse, and so that helped me think about why people around the world want to acquire and display art, and that loosened up the European boundaries. And also, I began to realize that within the universal impulse, people collect different kinds of things. And so I started getting more and more interested in different sorts of things. And in the global patterns of collecting over time, and as I think you're going to hear extensively, some of the most interesting developments in the global history of collecting are what's happening now around the collecting of East Asian art. And so you can be as much of a Europeanist as you want, but there's just no getting around the role that East Asian art is now playing in these sort of tectonic shifts in market value and in patterns of collecting. And in particular, so again, but before I came here, I wrote a book on private museums. So that's museums founded by one person or a couple, and in which the taste of the individual or the couple is preserved in some shape or to some degree. And that was a book, what ended up being called A Museum of One's Own. And it was particularly interested in letting this one type of museum loosen up the boundaries between types of collecting, because I was very interested in how in the first golden age of private museums, which is between about, say, 1890 and 1940, patterns in taste and collecting shifted very, very radically. So once I had let go of all ideas of any kind of inherently good taste and was just interested in historical patterns of collecting and display, then that allowed me to become aware that, and I see Constance in the audience, there in the back row. Constance is writing a senior thesis about the growth of private museums in China now. And whatever measure you use, quality or quantity, the big boom in private museums is happening in China now. So that became more and more interesting to me. And then I came here and was handed the Introduction to the History of Art, which for all of you who are at Columbia is very different from the art humanities structure, because it's a global course and very much organized around relationships or encounters between different cultures. And that the evolution of that course also yanked me out of an exclusive focus on European art and made me think a lot about world art and patterns patterns in the making as well as the collecting of art. And that's where I've landed right about now.
Hey, hi everyone, I'm Serena. I first of all want to say I'm really honored to be speaking on the panel with Anna and Fiona. I am a specialist at Christie's in the Asian 20th Century Contemporary Art Department. So what that includes is artists working in the 20th century, usually in typically Western media, as opposed to ink on paper, which is handled by our Chinese modern paintings department, and then of course anything contemporary. A little bit about my background. I graduated from Wellesley College in 2012. I studied art history and East Asian studies.
Oh.
Yeah.
My first job. I loved it there.
Oh, really? Yeah. There's always a Wellesley connection everywhere. I spent 1 year at the National Palace Museum in Taipei the year after I graduated, doing a fellowship there. My studies had been more focused in traditional works of art, so I really was interested in porcelain, jade, and lacquer. In my senior year at Wellesley, I had done an internship at Christie's, and I totally fell in love with the fact that we were allowed to touch everything, like, all the time. So I knew I wanted to go back there. When my fellowship was coming to a close in Taipei, one of the specialists that I'd worked with at Christie's told me about an opening in the Asian Contemporary Department, and I had some experience with contemporary, I didn't really have a very deep background in that area, but I thought, you know, okay, I could learn that. So I just started working in that department, and I've been there ever since. So in terms of what my role there actually entails, my main responsibility is to find artworks in the U.S. Or around North and South America, sometimes in Europe, and help clients who want to sell artwork in our auctions in Hong Kong and Shanghai do that. Also help, I guess, clients based in the U.S. or North and South America to buy from the auctions in Hong Kong. So it's a pretty different, I wouldn't say entirely non-academic background, but it's a very different part of the art world than my fellow panelists.
Thank you again for joining us tonight, and we can now go into our panel discussion. There will be questions dedicated to specific speaker, but you are all more than welcome to raise any comments at any time. And my first question explores the metamorphosis from private collection to public museum. The collection at Asian Society Museum was initially established by Mr. and Mrs. John D. Rockefeller III, who contributed around 250 Asian artworks and artifacts from diverse nations. So Ms. Prosser, how Asian Society Museum's collection has grown since the original bequest? Could you describe the relationship between a private collection taste and a museum's ideology? Is there any like transformation, integration, or consistency or inconsistency?
Okay, how many of you are familiar with the Asian Society collection? Okay, some of you are. So let me give you a little bit of background, because some of you aren't at all. John D. Rockefeller III came from a family of collectors, and in particular his parents, John D. Rockefeller Jr. and Blanchette Hooker Rockefeller, were collectors in their own right. Jr. was famous for, he collected many things, but in the Asian realm he collected Chinese porcelain, particularly Kangxi period and Fa Hua ware. So it was very, very focused. And his mother, Abby Aldrich Rockefeller, in the realm of Asia was much more, she was much more open. The father was much more conservative. She collected everything from Japanese prints and textiles to Buddhist art. The father was a very conservative Christian, and he was not terrifically comfortable with non-Christian art around. So John D. Rockefeller III basically grew up in a household where there was Asian art everywhere and integrated with all different kinds of stuff. His parents were these great collectors, and of course, you know, both Junior and Abby collected all kinds of things in European and American things as well. So when John D. Rockefeller III graduated from college, he went on an around the world tour, and he visited Asia, and he was particularly in China and in Japan, and very much struck by his experiences there. And then after the Second World War, he returned to Asia in kind of a semi-diplomatic role. And he became involved in a project to bring the first exhibition of Japanese art from Japan to the United States. And the show traveled a number of different venues in the United States, starting with and it was very, very popular and very effective. And he saw that there was a huge role, because of course after the Second World War, the feelings towards Japan were quite negative. But he saw that that actually learning about culture could kind of turn people's attitudes around. And so he started thinking about the role of culture and diplomacy. And in 1956, he founded Asia Society. Japan Society already existed, and he recognized the need for another institution in New York that would deal with the rest of Asia. And he thought about whether, you know, there should be an India Society and a Korea Society. And he just decided, okay, you know, we need it all. Let's put it all together. And he wanted that institution to deal with policy and education and business. He really felt that if Americans were going to interact with Asia, they had to understand Asian culture, that you couldn't effectively do business or have a government to exchange if you didn't understand the other culture. And the window into that was art for him. And he was a smart guy, and so he recognized that if he was going to seriously start collecting Asian art, that he should have an advisor. And he found that advisor in Sherman E. Lee, who was a specialist in Asian art. Introduction to Asian art was years and years of the standby intro to Asian art book that they used in all the universities here in the United States. And Sherman Lee had become director of the Cleveland Museum of Art and was collecting for them by this time. And Sherman agreed to help Rockefeller collect. They'd actually met each other in Japan, and they were both involved with the sort of Japan exhibit. And so JDR III was really being kind of coached by Sherman Lee. And when Jeff Hooker Rockefeller, who was JDR III's partner in collecting, was part of the conversation when they decided if they were going to collect something or not. But the Asia stuff was really his big focus when Jeff was focused on modern art. So it's kind of hard to separate the sort of the curatorial eye, the museum eye, from the individual collector's eye in this case, because Sherman Lee really helped J.D. Arthur focus the way he built his collection, and the decision that they made together was that if he was going to collect, he was going to collect in a way that they wanted to collect pieces that represented kind of the creme de la creme of art produced throughout the histories of a number of different Asian countries. So in general, the quality of the collection across the board is really high. As with any collection, there were some mistakes made, but actually very few in this case. It's quite a small type collection, which has, there are themes that run throughout the collection. Like you can follow the transmission of Buddhist art across Asia using the collection. This is one example. So it stands as a very strong group of objects in this way. Because of the quality of the collection, it very much fits within the definition of the traditional museum, the traditional high art museum. And as sort of over time, Asia Society, actually since its beginnings, also organized special exhibitions of Asian art. And we've continued to do that. But over the last kind of decade and a half, there's been more and more interest in the institution of contemporary art. And we started to do exhibitions of contemporary art, specifically the one we're most famous for is Inside Out, this exhibition of, an early exhibition of Chinese art, which was before the whole boom in contemporary Chinese art. And it sort of helped, it was really what introduced a lot of Americans to contemporary Chinese art. In 2007, our director at that time, Melissa Chu, decided that we were going to start collecting contemporary art. So she wanted to do it again, she wanted in a kind of very focused way. And at that time, knowing what the prices of art were, what people were collecting, she made a kind of just judicious decision that Asia Society was going to collect contemporary video art and photography, new media. And that's what she focused on during her whole time at Asia Society. We now have a new director who started 2 years ago, Wu Beitan, and he is now, has begun what he sees as a phase two in our collecting, and that's with a focus on paper art. In terms of the traditional collection, we have very, very judiciously added to the collection traditional works that kind of fill gaps or extend the story that we're telling over the years. But with each of the curators who have been there, we've added one or two or three pieces, but it's not a huge number of pieces that we've added. Now, the definition of Asia and Asia Society has changed with our current president, who's now using the UN definition of Asia, which means that virtually all the Islamic world is included. And JDR and Blanchett did not collect any Islamic art whatsoever. So right now, actually, we're in the midst of probably the plan is to purchase our first most examples of Qurans. But of course, it's very difficult at this period of time to collect anything that comes from Iran or Iraq or Afghanistan, as you probably know, and we just can't do it legally, or it's just too problematic to bring things from one place to another. And we're talking about this sort of the idea of globalized world and transmission from one place to another. What we've decided that we're focusing on are examples of Islamic art, Islamic calligraphy that have emerged in other Asian countries. So we're probably going to add a work from Central Asia and a work from China in the near future to the collection. And what's kind of nice about that is that because of the illuminated component of these works, you can also see painting that connects to the Islamic world, but also connects to China. You see motifs that one would see in textiles or in architecture in China in these Qurans, which are completely different format. And the good thing is that we can also connect the calligraphy to Chinese, East Asian calligraphy. We don't have a lot of calligraphy in the collection, but we have enough to be able to tell a little bit of a story and to sort of compare and contrast those traditions, which actually share some elements, like for both of those cultures, calligraphy is considered the highest art.
I'm curious, so for Professor Ikenet, could you provide some insights on the topic in terms of like the history of collecting for East Asian art?
Well, the short version is increasing. There are a number of factors involved, the most obvious of which is more disposable income and a greater freedom to spend it in East Asia. But what I find especially interesting is what I would call soft repatriation. So there have been a number of big drawn-out battles about bringing artwork back to where it was made. And the mother of those battles is over in the Elgin Marbles. And there's been some fighting in the court of public opinion, but most of it uses international law. And there are cases in which law has worked, like inside the United States, NAGPRA, one of those endless legal acronyms, has worked pretty well. But internationally, it turns out repatriation stalls. And what we've seen in happening in China is a very quiet decision to just use the market to repatriate objects. And collecting is motivated by a desire to bring things back that were bought for a variety of good and bad reasons, like Kanji porcelain, right? I'll just give you one example. So why is it that one of the greatest pairs of porcelain vases in Chinese porcelain vases in the world are called Percival David vases and belong to the British Museum? Right. So there are issues like that. And maybe the emblematic case, which is the new counterpart to Elgin Marbles, is the whole Zodiac Head story, which is, we can talk about the Zodiac Head story in greater detail if you want to. I probably should start going down that rabbit hole. But what's doubly fascinating for me about that case is how effective the use of the market has been to get those heads back to China and undo what is perceived as an unjust mode of 19th century collecting, so on the one hand. And without getting into too many details, what's really brilliant is that if you use the right combination of intimidation and money in the market, you can actually keep on lowering the price you pay for things to get them back. So there have been some brilliant tactical moves of that sort. And the other side of it that I find completely fascinating is that it's such a creative set of tactics that it has inspired contemporary art. So as a lot of you know, there's a contemporary set of zodiac cards made by Ai Weiwei. And what that shows me as a historian is that one creative idea leads to another, and that there are porous boundaries between collecting patterns and creation patterns that make, so I would say that market pressures are not the antithesis of creativity, on the contrary. Some of the most interesting phenomena have been in how those forces have interacted recently.
I think one particularly interesting example of this was a few years ago at Christie's. I think it was maybe 2016, spring 2016. Christie's was offering one of the largest Zhou Dynasty bronzes to ever come to auction.
What a great example.
Yeah. And I believe it was the first time coming to auction, or certainly the first time when there was a lot of Chinese buying power, and this piece was coming to auction. Ultimately, rather than, we had it on display during our Asian Art Week preview, and ultimately, rather than selling it for the highest price possible at auction, multiple really important and large collectors from China got together and said they would make a private offer to return the painting to its
bronze.
Own museum. Oh yeah, yeah. So he's still talking about paintings. The bronze to its home museum, which was, where was it? I don't remember off the top of my head, but it was returned to its home museum, where the lid to the vessel was. So.
Yeah. And that it's also that was a fascinating example of how in the East Asian case, the lines between private collecting and government collecting are interestingly blurred in ways that usefully make the boundaries between those things in Western countries very strange to us, which is good. It's always good when what you assume becomes strange. And so it was a consortium of individuals, and then suddenly the object turns up in something called a museum. And when I was visiting Shanghai, what did I see but a huge banner saying, this great bronze, Fan Lei, was going to be the center of a big display in Shanghai. And I thought, oh, okay, that's because you can have a museum with virtually no acquisition, a quote museum with virtually no acquisition budget, but when there's a strong will to repatriate something, consortiums of individuals can be brought together who will substitute for an acquisition budget. And yet, the object becomes very unproblematically part of a language of cultural heritage and pride.
Yeah, sometimes it's very difficult to draw like a clear line between private collections and museum like government collections. And I'm interested in an artist you just mentioned, Ai Weiwei. who is kind of controversial in the world. And so I'm wondering if there's like any stereotypical expectation that is imposed on Asian artists, or like do you perceive any differences in the interpretation and appreciation of East Asian art between Western and Eastern audience? Because obviously for Ai Weiwei, there are very like dramatic views on him from different parties. So I'm wondering what your opinion would be.
Well, I bet there are three different kinds of stories that could be told about Ai Weiwei.
Yeah.
I'm happy to launch in. Well, here's what I understand to be the two basic interpretations of Ai Weiwei. So, in the West, he's an emblem of free speech. And he's a hero. And he casts the government as the bad guy. And I went to hear him speak in the fall. And here's just an example of how brilliantly he knows how to be part of that kind of a story. So someone from the audience asked him, so what is the biggest effect that your art has had on your native country? And he says, they let me leave. So he's a genius. I think of that, there can be no doubt. Not a genius, what? So what I gather is the other version is that he's playing Western collectors and the Western press, because he knows exactly what buttons to push about their ideas about art and the genius and free speech, and that he's made a very great deal of money doing this. So sometimes two different stories can both be true simultaneously. I often feel that's what I gather the two versions are. What do the two of you think?
I have to agree with that. We actually don't really offer his work in Asia. His markets mm-hmm. are primarily in London and New York. Reasons that you mentioned, there just aren't. I mean, his market is at a place where you're spending at least $30,000-$50,000 on a sculpture, and it's usually something kind of heavy and unwieldy. So that's another several thousand dollars to ship it to wherever you want it to go. I think that, you know, in terms of all the things that Chinese or even just more generally East Asian collectors could be spending their money on, that's not at the top of their list. But there's something about his work that really appeals to Western collectors. It's almost like contemporary export.
Well, I think he's obviously not the contemporary Chinese artist or contemporary non-American artist or non-Western artist who is very savvy about what the different markets are and is making work that appeals to a particular taste in one place and perhaps maybe not as much with him, but perhaps for another taste in another. One thing about the calligrapher Wang Dongling, who I think, you know, genuinely for a very long period of time has been interested in the West and Western's perception of calligraphy, and has developed this style of calligraphy or abstraction that allows somebody who cannot read Chinese characters at all to appreciate a work of art and not to feel uncomfortable about it because, in fact, it is, turns out that it really is just a completely abstract piece of art. And then he's done other things that, you know, combine the two and so on. But you have that all going on. I mean, the other thing that this kind of brings up, because, you know, we're all sitting here talking about contemporary art and the work of Ai Weiwei and, you know, that people are collecting it here, and we don't seem to have any problem with this, but remember that art has been crossing borders for thousands of years. Art has been collected for thousands of years from coast to coast. There's also been looting for thousands of years. But sometimes I find the discussion of cultural patrimony a little facile. It's not always just black and white, you know. They stole the Zodiac heads and brought them, you know, to Britain or wherever it is that they, you know, they ended up. Yes, sometimes that's the case. But sometimes when you're talking about a Chinese porcelain, including like a, you know, a Kangxi period porcelain, well, that legitimately was produced as an export ware. And sometimes in today's market, you have those same collectors who are trying to repatriate, you know, real important Chinese bronzes, also collecting and trying to repatriate things that I don't think that there really is an issue with their being abroad, because that was what they were originally intended to be. And, you know, and I personally see value in pieces of Western art being at museums in China, so Chinese people can see them there and that they're collected there and vice versa. And I think that's a way for us, you know, all to kind of be able to appreciate each other's cultures. But I think it's helpful, or it's useful for us to kind of really think about, you know, well, what is the context? Do we know what the original context was? What are the circumstances under which one piece was brought from one place to another place? You can't just paint it all with the same brush.
I think all the more so because what you see in the market, at least from my point of view, but you're going to help me here, is that in contemporary art, there are so many, there is such a globalized world that there are works of contemporary Chinese art that really immediately appeal to everybody. I'm thinking of Shan Huan's Family Tree, which I would say, I mean, one doesn't want to pronounce too much, but I would say that at least half of all art historians would say, oh yes, that's one of the great works of the early 20th century. And I've seen it cited, it's as a work within a work, which is about canonical greatness already. But then we can go back into the past, when you were saying about the calligraphy issue. So that's, and porcelain too, those are media that Westerners have a very hard time understanding the value of, and it's really a pity, but it's a big and therefore important act of cultural imagination to look at calligraphy and to ask yourself, why was it for centuries so much more important aesthetically than what we call paintings? Why was porcelain so much more valuable than we recognize now. And I feel that as collecting sort of shifts around, there's a chance to retroactively do some reconciliation of aesthetic values. And a museum I find very, very interesting in that way is the Peabody Essex Museum. So Peabody Essex started off with a collection of what most art historians thought was junk, because it was stuff that was passed back and forth, and it was intended to go from culture to culture, be exported and imported, and it was very often hybrid, and you'd have porcelains that were made in my pronunciation is horrible, Gendigen, but then I would have European motifs on them, and the Peabody Museum, Peabody Essex, collected them, not despite, but because of that. And then, now the tides are turning, and all the Peabody Essex Museum's junk is starting to look like the hottest, most interesting stuff around. And they got a really huge donation from someone as a recognition that it now corresponds to a new aesthetic. And they do really, really great imaginative exhibitions, and they have just the most wonderful collections of what I think of as in-between things. And it's a fantastic museum, which just happens not to be in a major world capital, but well worth the trip.
They have that women's imperial footwear exhibition.
Yeah. Really, really dynamic museum, and a great place to think about getting a job. Yeah, because they have budgets like you wouldn't believe. Yeah. The Peabody Essex Museum. So they sometimes call themselves the PEM. And it is yes, it's really confusing because it's not in Essex.
Yeah.
Or Peabody.
It's easy to get to from Boston. So if you're in Boston, you go to the MFA, you can just take a train and get there.
Yeah. And they have permanent collections that are wonderful and eye opening. And as you say, one marvelous creative contemporary exhibition.
Yeah, as you mentioned that there's like a change in certain artworks. For example, the porcelain is like the value of the porcelain is growing at a much higher rate than like painting, for example.
Yeah.
And can we go deep into that topic to like talk about the growth of Chinese art market and what changes have emerged since Chinese entry into the global market? And what about the trends of the collecting of both like contemporary and non-contemporary art?
Okay. Do you have to pay more for porcelain than you used to?
Oh, sure. I mean, our collection, the value is, in fact, we sometimes our friends at the auction houses will help us to update our insurance values, because things have changed so much. I mean, it's obviously they've risen astronomically. But the other side of that is that you're probably all too young to remember that, but when I was in graduate school here, Japan was going through an economic boom, and our valuations in our database for our Japanese collections, our paintings and our ceramics, we had them, you know, reassessed during that time, and today's values for a lot of those things are lower than they were at that time. They haven't either equaled to or they've gone label or never reached that point again. I expect that the same thing is likely to happen with Chinese material one day as well, because things move cyclically, and someday in the future, you know, it could be 10 years from now, it could be 500 years from now, you know, the market will change, and you know, China probably won't be as strong as it is at the moment, and the values will go down. So it's a, you know, it's a, there are waves. You know, Japan now is getting stronger, so I'm expecting that the values of Japanese materials are going to go up again. But just because something is worth $100 million today doesn't mean that 20 years from now you're going to be able to sell it for $100 million.
Yeah, the values are very fluid. Everything is only temporary and rapidly changing. Just as one example, there was a painting by Zhao Lukiai appraised for a collector here in the States. Prior to, so Christie's in the last year broke the world record for the highest price for Zhao Lukiai's painting twice. So they broke it once and then broke their own record the next season. But anyways, during that one period, you know, I began talking to this collector prior to that, and the valuation for his painting was, I think it was around $3 to $5 million. This is someone who purchased it in the 60s for $5,000. It was the only painting he ever bought. And just liked it. And then, you know, following the two most recent records, because this work was from that period, and you know, the 1960s works are hot right now, this painting is now worth $7 million. So, you know, and that's just within the span of a year. So, you know, and then, you know, who knows? I mean, we have our big sales coming up at the end of May, and, you know, maybe taste will have shifted, and we'll begin preferring 1950s Zoe works instead, or 1980s works instead. And, you know, the value of this painting will go back down. So it's, I mean, everything is constantly in flux.
Actually, speaking of Zhao Key, I believe that he's one of those examples, going back to what we were talking about before, I think according to the current mainland Chinese regulations, you cannot export a Zhao Key to the United States. Like if I wanted to purchase a Zhao Key that was in China, I'm not allowed to do that as an American. He's one of the artists whose works are, you know, he's a national treasure now, and you can't do that. So, you know, again, it's just interesting to think about what national policy and national pride, you know, how they impact the market and impact our views of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable to connect and to move across borders, and which borders it's okay and it's not okay to move across, because of course there are lots of things that you can buy at auction in Hong Kong, you know, if you live in, say, Vietnam, and the collector that you could buy, and it's not a problem. But if I'm a collector in the United States, I really won't be doing it now, according to the way Chinese policy.
I know European countries do that too. So in America, it's a little more informal, but France has a very, very stern list of objects that cannot leave the country, and French curators, well, they'll tell a seller guess what? Your object can't leave the country, so its market value is now zero. And the collector says, oh no. And then the French state says, ah, but you could give it to a French museum. You would get a big break on your business taxes. So there are ways in which governments use, in a way, a kind of reverse relationship between market value and national heritage to keep things where they want them. But, you know, then you also have to ask yourself, oh, well, what does France mean? What does China mean? You know way more than I do, but I think there are cases of artists who would have been anathema in the Mao years, who would have been pronounced a disgrace to China and not Chinese at all. And now there's a desire to bring them back to where they belong, which it turns out is where they were banned and dismissed.
Well, Zhao, he's somewhat of a good example of that, having spent most of his life in France.
Yeah, speaking of Zhao Yun, I think there were a few exhibitions in the Asian Society in the past.
We had a big Zhao Yun exhibition about 4 years ago, 3 years ago.
Yeah, were they from like his own like collection or from like other collections?
They were from other collections. I mean, there were pieces in that exhibition that were drawn from collections in Asia, collections here in the United States.
Those collections must be like in collecting many years ago, right? Mm-hmm. Because as you said, like his work cannot be asked for.
Right.
Well, from China, but most of his work is, I mean, there's plenty of his work in collections in Taiwan, Hong Kong, US, France, everywhere. So, that's only a small project.
And, so I'm wondering, for Ms. Taylor, what kind of people and clients are interested in East Asian art in the Western market?
So there's a few different things going on. I think that there are people who have been interested in Chinese contemporary art since the late 90s, early 2000s, when there was the first kind of boom. Mm-hmm. And they're typically interested in what I call like classical Chinese contemporary, so like Zhang Huan's family tree, Zheng Fenzi, Zhang Xiaogang, like all the top names. And I mean, especially, as far as like later works by Zhang Xiaogang and Yuan Mingzhi, the market is primarily in the West, but we would choose to offer those works in New York or London or Hong Kong because Chinese buyers are not, or I shouldn't say just Chinese buyers, Asian buyers are not as interested in adding those type of works to their collection. And then alongside that, there's also Western collectors who are collecting younger Chinese artists or younger Asian artists. And they aren't even necessarily considering them in the same way. They're not necessarily considering themselves to be collectors of Asian contemporary art the way the slightly older generation of Western collectors do. They're just, living in an international world, and these are artists that are represented by galleries here in Chelsea, shows in Paris. They're shown at Basel. Like it's a much more international world, especially for the younger generation. So, for example, I was working with a client in our most recent auction who had just bought a David Hockney painting in New York. And he wanted to buy our Zhao Zhao painting in Hong Kong to hang alongside it. It's really a range, but I think there's a pretty big divide. divide between the collectors who are kind of focused on like Asian contemporary as a siloed category versus those who are interested in artists who happen to be of Asian descent.
So like they're like the clients are like more diverse in terms of their collecting habits.
Yeah, and I would say out of all of those clients, I mean there really are very few people that are that these days there are very few people that say I'm an Asian contemporary art collector, you know, or I'm a Chinese contemporary art collector. They're collecting kind of across multiple categories. Western post-war contemporary art, and the same goes for young Chinese collectors. You know, they're not as focused on repatriation. They're, you know, they have gone to school overseas in the U.S., in London, in Canada, wherever. You know, they're well traveled. They're people of the world, and so they're interested in all kinds of art, not just Asian contemporary art specifically, because that's not the only kind of art that they connect to, like their life experiences.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, there are more and more like private young collectors in China nowadays start to build their own collections. So there are emergence and rising of private museums. And private museums such as the Museum in Shanghai and Today Museum in Beijing all strive for introducing new phase of art museum in China. And for the Chinese, also global audience. How do you see the private museum boom in China? And do you think they have done a successful job?
So I'm just gonna comment on, I mean, contemporary art isn't really my thing, but I have been in China in the last few years and been to some of these museums. I've been to a museum. I think that what will be really interesting is to see what happens with these museums in the future, how they develop, because one thing that's really obvious as an American who works in the nonprofit world, museum world, and goes to China and you see these contemporary art museums is that the Chinese, the American notion of philanthropy is so alien to Chinese culture, right? A lot of the private museums in China that have been popping up are more vanity museums. Now, the same thing happened, vanity museums in this country as well, also early on. So my question is, well, what happens to these museums? What happens to these objects as these collectors get older? Will they leave their collections to the state, or will they take the family money and basically create endowments for their museums so that they will exist in the future, or will their children inherit the works and then sell them or continue to grow the museums? I mean, we don't know exactly what's going to happen. And as there are more and more generations of young Chinese people who study abroad in places like America and Europe, will they take back with them different ideas about how these kinds of institutions can function or not? It's hard for us to predict, right?
From my point of view, museums maybe could and should be primarily educational institutions where you learn by looking, but the reality is also that museums are very bound up in real estate speculation and in urban redesign. And one of their functions is to anchor entire neighborhood projects. So in Shanghai, the development of the West Bund, notably, where the river is just lined with one museum after another. And of course, I love the museums. I love crawling from museum to museum. But I wonder if that's not just a sort of rim that's supposed to create a whole neighborhood behind it. And it seems to me there are development forces that are much, much larger than that play in the museum boom. Yeah. And there's also the issue of tourism. So museums have become very beloved tourist oases because some people come to the Asian Society because it's really nice. And you have a great restaurant. I was brought, I've named no names, but I was brought by someone at the Frick who said, you know, really, it's just much nicer to hang out there. I said, okay. And so there, the museums have restaurants, they have gift shops, they have bus stops, they become the center of brochures that tell you this is what you can do in the city. So they can be engines of tourist economy also. And as you say, what are they going to turn out to have really accomplished in 40 years? Well, maybe it's going to be something that doesn't have much to do with art, but might really reshape a lot of cities.
I've been going back and forth between the United States and China since the mid-80s, and you know, every time you go back to a city, it's completely changed. You're not there for a couple of years and it looks totally different. So I can't help but wonder, you know, this fantastic, you know, architectural, these great projects, right? These great expansive projects that include museums and other things. I mean, will they be there in 15 years? Will something completely different and even more extraordinary in some other way have replaced it?
And then there's a very different model in Japan where the garden is very important. So you were mentioning the Rockefellers, and did the parents have a Japanese garden around their summer home?
Yeah, well, there's also if anybody's ever been to Pocantico Hills, where the Rockefeller family home is, Kaikin, there's actually a Japanese house and garden there, and then they also have, so this is Junior's generation. They also had a family home in Maine, which is no longer there. It was raised, but there's an Abby Aldrich Rockefeller garden there, and that's part of that is sort of, it has Asian components. One of the things it has actually is a part of the garden. There's a wall around it with tiles on top, and the tiles are from the Forbidden City. I mean, there are ones that were discarded, but it's
There is a whole generation of Americans with pseudo-Japanese gardens around estates and museums. But the curious thing is that sort of silly idea, although it had its good intentions, but that silly idea has become a very powerful kind of architectural model in Japan, where the museums, there are new museums that have that are, first of all, they're extremely beautiful architecture, and so they're engines of Japanese architectural history in a way which I think is very particular to Japan. And also, they have these really gorgeous buildings, and so I felt when I was there as if the museum has sort of relayed the garden-producing function of the temple. And so now some of the great contemporary garden designs, I think, are genuinely great, are happening around museums. And it's like a much improved version of what the Boston Museum of Fine Arts did in a kind of pokey way around thinking.
Yeah, that reminds me of the Isabella Garden
Museum.
Yeah, it's also like based on the like a garden, and also houses and objects.
Yeah. And that's such an interesting example in the history of collecting, because so the Meiji government really turned its back on traditional Japanese art and demanded the instant modernization of culture, and was remarkably effective at that. And then around 1900, it was a group of Bostonians who went to Japan and became the champions of traditional Japanese art. And they befriended someone called Nobukuro Kakuzo, who wrote one of the great nationalist cultural tracts, where he almost invented an idea of authentic Japanese-ness, which opposed the Meiji government. So that was a kind of resistance movement from within a country that was remarkably effective. And one of his great allies was Isabel Stewart Gardner, this eccentric Boston lady, who she just sort of liked annoying male experts in the Boston art world. And Okakura Kakuzo did that. So she aided and abetted his project of turning the clock around in some inverse-reverse way in Japan. And that's a case in which the most unexpected allies are formed to do the strangest time warp things to history. And yet, okay, one of the residues is that I don't know if any of you have been to Boston this fall, but there was a really wild, fun show called Battle Royale, which, well, again, it's about the relationship between contemporary art and collecting patterns. Murakami is actually an extremely good art historian. Wow, he really knows Japanese art history. And his work is extremely popular, and you know, all kinds of people loved Murakami. And so he got the Museum of Fine Arts to bring out all of these great treasures which they acquired around 1900. But in a wonderful sort of revenge of history, the whole exhibition is driven by Murakami's popularity and his taste. And then the Boston Museum of Fine Arts has obligingly provided these treasures, which it's not about to let go of.
Yeah. And going back to our initial question, which is the museum boom in China, with Ms. Taylor, have any comments on that? Maybe perhaps for the younger generation?
In terms of the museum boom in China, I mean, frankly, like speaking as an auction house specialist, we're lucky to have them, because there are some works that are too large to fit in people's homes. I mean, if you think of some of the works that were exhibited in the recent Guggenheim show, you know, those are things that only many of those artists only work in large scale. So those, you know, in order for people to be able to see and experience those artists' work, it more or less has to be at a museum. So I think we're quite lucky that there are so many private museums with deep pockets who are willing to support those artists. And
also, well, it contributes to that generational shift that you're describing. I think that some of these museums show art from around the world, so they're boosting the market for all kinds of huge, big installation art. And there's a generation of Chinese museum goers who are extremely globally sophisticated about what's going on all over the place, partly because that's what these some of these new institutions are showing them.
Do you think the private museums would become like museums like MAT or like MoMA in the future? Perhaps they will be oriented toward the, like the broader public.
Well, I think the scenarios that you described will decide that. You know, for instance, it's entirely possible that all the contents of the Long Museum will get put up for auction.
Maybe
at Christie's, because that's a very expensive proposition, and much more expensive than I think the founders realized.
But I do think, what I think actually is, I think that we're in a transitional period now because Chinese collectors are, they become just much more sophisticated. Not only are there still collectors who are really interested in Chinese art, but you know, I can see in my own field, and you know this from working at the auction houses too, that Chinese collectors are, you know, many are interested in purchasing. You know, they start to get interested in purchasing Tibetan art, and people purchasing Tibetan art, and then they, you know, sort of naturally moved over to Nepal, and, you know, they're moving into India now as they learn, you know, more and more about these particular types of art and the influences on them, then the scope of their collecting interest widens. And you see Chinese collectors now who are also collecting Western art. And I think it has to happen. There are either museum galleries in China and other galleries in China that are you know, state-funded institutions that are collecting more than just Chinese art now. So I think that yes, I mean, to some degree, the you know, the scope of the art museum in China naturally has to change as the interest of the collector changes. And clearly what's happening with, as you see more Chinese private collectors expanding into these areas of collecting, then the institutions also become interested in those areas of collecting. And that doesn't necessarily mean that the private collections are going to transform into something like the Metropolitan Museum, a great public art museum, but I think that the nature of public art museums will naturally change as you know, taste becomes more global.
Yeah, and some really there are some really wild possibilities that are conceivable. Many of the greatest old works of Chinese art are in Taiwan because Chiang Kai-shek and his wife have extremely good tastes. Well, because she went to Russell. but she did go to Wellesley, and so do I feel 100% confident that those works will all be in Taiwan in 100 years? No, for reasons that you all know.
But also, if you look at, I mean, again, if we look back at Japan in the 80s, I mean, all of a sudden they started buying up Impressionist art in Japan big time, and you know, all the great paintings that came on the market went to Japan. Well, then when the market tanked, the things came back on the market, and
even still now. Last week we had a Japanese single owner collection of photography that came up for auction that did very well. If I remember correctly, the Modigliani that we sold a few seasons ago was coming from Japan. We've had multiple important collections of Chinese porcelain and paintings coming from Japan as well in recent years. And sometimes coming back to New York to research Chinese collectors. I think as things progress, I mean, my hope is that my department, Asian 20th Century and Contemporary Art, won't exist in the future. I think that, you know, the way things are moving, it will slowly just become integrated into the larger area of postmodern contemporary art, and there really isn't any reason for it to be siloed. As people's, you know, experiences become more and more international, or also the people who are buying these artists become more and more international.
Yeah, I also have an example to add. So last summer I was working at the Palace Museum, the Info Business Museum in Taipei, and I saw on the exhibition schedule that there will be an exhibition on Monet, like in 2020, which is very like different from what Palace Museum was doing in the past.
Is that the one from the Osei?
Yeah, I think so.
I was there a couple of weeks ago. They're very excited about that.
Yeah, and when I was in the Palace Museum, there was also an exhibition about jewelry from Chomet. It's a French jewelry brand, which is very famous.
Last year they did a big exhibition of Indian art with lots of sculptures and other Indian materials from India, everything came from India. And I actually was recently talking to some people from the Palace Museum who, you know, they're looking at doing more and more of these kinds of projects where they're doing innovative kinds of shows, both with collections from private collections in China, but also with ones from foreign countries. So they're really expanding. You know, they have a new exhibition space, and they have to fill it. So they're looking all over the place. And of course, they have a lot of visitors, so they make a lot of money, so they can afford to do it.
Yeah, and so the department I was worked in is actually on creative products and services. So we basically were responsible for designing and marketing of the new cultural products based on the museum's collection. And so you may have heard of, like, there are many popular products based on the Palace Museum collection. For example, the tape that has all kinds of motifs on it. And I think they've been doing a great job in promoting the awareness of the traditional arts and culture in China. And I'm thinking for Asian Society Museum. So as a museum dedicated for Asian art and culture, how does Asian Society Museum cultivate deeper understanding of like traditional Asian art for audience from both the East and the West in the context of contemporary life?
In the context of contemporary life.
Yeah.
Well, I think that one thing that we do, which, I mean, we've been doing for quite a long period of time, is that when we do special exhibition projects, we try to engage specialists who are not only, you know, so we get different perspectives and also you know, sort of top specialists from different places, and it's a more of a collaborative and an attempt to represent where scholarship is across the world. For us as Asia Society, one thing that's a little bit of a challenge, I mean, for me as a curator, is that, you know, sometimes we talk about, well, we need to have our label copy in Chinese as well as English, because we get, especially, you know, during the Asia Week and that kind of thing, we get lots and lots of Chinese visitors. I feel quite mixed about that, because I feel like if we're going to provide materials in Chinese for our Chinese visitors, then we should be providing, you know, our Korean visitors with, you know, Korean language. And in an ideal world, we have everything accessible in every single language, but in reality, who has the money and the time to employ people to translate everything in all languages? But I think as time goes on, I think things will develop so that in fact we have more materials accessible in both languages. But I also think that because of the internet now, even if people can't travel to Asia Society, we put a lot of our scholarship and a lot of our imagery and work online, which makes it accessible to the whole world. I know that there's especially one particular example that I can give you is I worked on an exhibition a few years ago, which was focused on a particular monastery in Tibet called Densitil, which was destroyed by Red Guards, and but it was known as the most fabulous monastery in Tibet before that, and it had these wonderful gilt copper sculptures that were part of these interior stupas, and they were. These stupas were completely destroyed and actually taken apart, and they were being set to be melted down to create copper wire, and some of them were spirited out of the country and ended up in Western collections, and some of them ended up in collections in China. There are a number of those pieces now in the Capitol Museum in Beijing, and some of them ended up at Pyongyang. And what we did with this project was, as best as we could, try to gather up a bunch of these pieces and try to reconstruct what these stupas, these tashigomam, originally looked like. And we put together a catalog to go along with that. And collectors of Tibetan art in China really, really wanted that catalog because it was new scholarship, and we unfortunately printed too few of those catalogs, and so now everybody wants the catalog, but you can't get hold of it. But we've had lots of offers since then for it to be printed and translated in China. It hasn't happened yet, but I expect it will happen eventually. And I think that, you know, in those kinds of ways, there'll be more engagement with the audiences in China, because it's, you know, there's the interest there, and of course it's, you know, it's a great market also for us. And because people who are interested in art are traveling so much back and forth now, we're getting visitorship that's really international.
Good fun reproductions are not to be dismissed. I think it's possible size great wave is the most recognizable work of art in the world now, rather than the Mona Lisa. language is a this is the characters. It's not just the language. So I guess that's part of the language, but you know, if you're stumbling through a catalog in Italian and you're American, you can maybe sort of get the point, sort of. But when you're faced with these characters, you're really
shut out. For the other way,
and quite, yeah.
But so, I mean, now, and the other way around, though, with you know, educated Chinese people, I mean, most people have to take English in China when they're in school, so have some recognition of English language. And then people with higher education, of course, a lot of them are really fluent in English now. So I think, you know, English is now kind of the international language. Now maybe 50 years from now it will be Chinese, you know, but you know, when I was still a kid, it was still French. So you never know.
Yeah. Thank you for your comments, and I think we can now take questions from the audience. So you can raise your hands if you have any questions for the speakers.
So I have a lot of questions. This is a really actually discussion, but the thing that I'm most interested in hearing about your opinions is going back to the beginning of the discussion was market pressures and creativity in terms of contemporary art, like, where does the value lie? Because for like more like older paintings or like older works of art or objects, there's like history, there's like provenance, there's like things that gone through. But like for contemporary art that's new, like aside from that there being like the Chinese contemporary art that they're being sold really high prices, what where's the value? Like it's not like craftsmanship anymore. Like, where is the value for contemporary art? And then where will the value continue if it will continue? Thanks. I know it's not what I said, but just wanted to hear. Oh.
Your question is essentially, what is the value of contemporary art?
And then how does the market constrain creativity of contemporary artists? Mm-hmm. What do they have to cope with the market, and then do they have to sell, and that kind of stuff?
Okay. I guess I'll start with the first part of your question is kind of difficult to tackle, because the value of contemporary art is, I guess, the value that we place in it, you know. Of course, there are plenty of people who sort of treat it the same way that they would treat any other type of investment. In terms of people collecting purposes, you know, the value really is what we place in it, right? I mean, the cost of, right, like with porcelain, it's this, you know, incredibly well-crafted vessel, or sometimes, you know, like something that uses a lot of precious materials. Whereas with most contemporary art, it's, you know, oil on canvas, yeah, or ceramic or whatever, right? But to get to the second part of your question, in terms of pressures on creativity, I definitely think that, that specifically speaking about Chinese contemporary artists, but this certainly applies to other contemporary artists as well. After the big boom of Chinese contemporary art in the early 2000s, there's sort of this whole other second generation of artists who are kind of like the B and C list artists that were sort of following on the coattails of political pop and cynical realism, and kind of creating something that had an aesthetic that that fit into that, but you know, and Western collectors were snapping it up. But today, now that you know the bubble has burst and it's kind of a more regular market, while the kind of top Chinese contemporary artists who I guess really had a lot of they were really presenting new, fresh ideas at that time, and they still have markets, but the sort of hanger-on or is that, you know, on the second tier, I would say, you have no market at all. I mean, you know, it kind of, I guess what I'm trying to say is what goes around comes around. Those, you know, those people might have, they're kind of just the flash in the pan. Have a long-standing place in either the market or in art history. But I mean, you know, beyond that, there are plenty of artists who are excellent business people who I don't think are necessarily restricted by market pressures. Yoshitomo Nara, for example, he will, he has a series of sculptures that are like these stacks of heads on top of one another, and each one is an individual work, but he'll use the same mold to create like one head, a two head work, a three head work. So the value is higher because they're not addition pieces, but he saved money by using the same mold like multiple times. So like, you know, like there are different ways that artists respond to market pressures, and it doesn't always have to inhibit their creativity.
Yeah, I'm an eternal optimist, so I think there's a sort of steady state of genius, and it overcomes anything and everything, and a really great mind will analyze all the conditions that it comes out of, including the market. So I think there will always be artists who do more to help later generations understand the market than the market ever did to help understand the artist.
Meanwhile, there are artists who are extremely relevant in society, I would say, but have very difficult markets because they only create giant works that are made of materials that degrade over time. You know, like no one can put that in their home. So,
there are plenty of artists who are, I kind of wish would pay a little more attention to the marketplace.
Yeah,
well,
sometimes being
very sort of narcissistic is a sign of your indulgence,
I think also that, you know, I mean, just in terms of, you know, as a curator, if I'm talking to somebody who is thinking about collecting, and I think a lot of curators will say this same kind of thing. If you want to collect, find something that you love, something that really you're drawn to and really interests you, because over time, as your eye improves and you learn more, your taste may change a bit, but I think that if there's something that really draws you to it, it's going to, your interest is going to continue to be there over time. And I think the real value to art is what it, you know, it does for you, and it gives to you as a collector. There's no way, you know, collecting art as an investment is like going into any other kind of investment. It's volatile, and you may be really lucky, or you may not be lucky. In terms of the art that, you know, you collect 50 years from now, even if it's somebody, you know, by somebody famous like John Kwan, we don't really know, you know, 100 years from now whether his works will still be valued. Maybe nobody cares about him 100 years from now. But then 200 years from now, all of a sudden he'll emerge again, you know, and people will recognize how important he was. I mean, we see this, you know, we see these cycles when you're in a museum, you know, you see these cycles over time. That's actually one of the reasons we always say, you know, if we're not stupid, hopefully, we try not to deaccession things because, you know, yesterday's junk might be tomorrow's most valued item. You just don't know.
Of course, I will, as you expect, give a plug for taking art history courses. Because, first of all, most contemporary art refers to the past of art, and if you can catch those references, the art is more fun. But also, about your passions, I think that when a lot of art history courses open up the gates to let your passions speak more clearly when you're looking at art, because your courses actually help you shed prejudices and also make you increasingly enjoy work that is very intellectually challenging. And that work, I think, has the best chance of lasting over time. You know, the quick fix is not, maybe not going to be so good in the long run, but as your art history courses build up your intellectual tolerance for difficulty, I think it guides you toward passions that are richer and richer and richer and more layered and complicated.
I would say that, you know, the best collectors, the collectors who have collected the strongest works and build the strongest collections are people who are incredibly passionate about what they collect, and they spend a lot of time educating themselves, reading, looking at things with other people who know what they're looking at. They, you know, form close relationships with dealers, with art historians, with museum people, with people at auction houses who really know what, you know, what they're looking at. And because of that, they're able to, you know, they keep on refining their eye and their taste, and they have a sense of, you know, where they want to move with the collection. You know, maybe something that they collected in the past, they recognize isn't really the best example of whatever they can get, and then they sell that, make some money, and, you know, buy something else that they think is going to make their collection strong.
Yes, I should say that one thing that makes the field of art history very different from other humanities is that many really knowledgeable people are in the market and in the museums. And they're, academics are fine too, but there's really top level expertise in different areas, and that's not true of like the German respect for other humanities departments, but there are modes of interconnecting excellence in many different domains in art.
Kind of back to the time of Camelot appearances and the physical
question is, specific to the Guggenheim exhibition, and because that one is very political in message, very political, and I was a little troubled when I visited it. And then later I saw the message from the curator, Alexandra Morel, and she said that explicitly saying that this exhibition at Guggenheim was for the American audience, and that power dynamic and how museums shape public's opinion on East Asian art, and specifically Chinese art and Chinese politics and Chinese culture, and how that reflect back onto market and how market influence the artist's creativity. And I guess my question is about who has a bigger power in this cycle of, you know, pushing and pulling.
So. Oh. The most sophisticated anti-repatriation arguments are global arguments.
Yeah.
So yes, absolutely. Smart people don't just say, well, I have it, so I won't give it back. They say, well, we live in a global world, and there's all this travel, and tourists move around, and anyway, who's to say that a country is really exactly the same as it was when this art was made. And yes, so the debate goes on. The debate goes on and on. It's interesting that you bring up the Guggenheim exhibition, and it's really too bad we don't have our fourth person. I felt that there was a sort of political correctness that stifled it. An important debate that should have been bigger around that show. For those of you who don't know, there even before the show opened, people who had, by definition, never seen the works of art involved, who said they were defending the rights of animals, mounted a petition, 600,000 people signed it. But the big issue, from my point of view at least, was that death threats and threats of personal violence were issued against Guggenheim curators if two works weren't withdrawn. And the Guggenheim they caved in. And although there were some interesting statements and labels by curators and very interesting protests written on a vomit bag that was put in the vitrine. And I felt that there should have been more said about how this was really a clash between cultural priorities. I felt that it was shoved under the rug way too fast. I just don't personally. I don't think that the right of the Chinese artists in question to have their work shown should automatically be less important than an interpretation of.
I still have a difficult time with that controversy. I mean, I can really see it from both sides, I suppose.
Yeah, one of the works of art was a video, correct me if I'm wrong, but it was a video of two dogs lunging at each other. And first of all, the dogs don't reach each other and attack.
This is called Two Dogs That Can't Touch Each Other.
Yeah, okay. And also, but art historians tend to think, especially the academic ones, that there's a very important difference between reality and art. And I think it's important. important not to confuse real animals and pictures of animals. So there was another work that was going to have lots of live insects.
Yeah.
In Ukraine, so that situation is a little bit more complicated. But, and again, I know that this is a really stereotypically kind of Western thing to say, but the artists who were represented in that show had taken a lot of personal risks in their art and in their lives. And I thought, wow, there are a lot of Americans who just have no idea how courageous you have to be to do that kind of thing.
Graduation thesis about Chinese creative industry developing conditions. So, as like President Xi mentioned and suggests that it is a good time for China to build our own cultural confidence. So, various art initiative programs developed in recently. For example, those like real estate speculator, they can have really good discount if they use land to build the art-related activity. For example, like urban planning, art-related neighborhood building, and you can see a lot of government policy right now. They have like benefit for art market as well. As for example, like Christie's is allowed to have a sale in Shanghai, which is not before. So we can see a freer art market. So my question is, how do you see the function of government when they promote our culture and promote the contemporary art? So what kind of role they play in this area?
Well, it's tricky because state sponsorship of art can take many different forms, and so I don't think one can say that it's necessarily good or bad. So what is it that I heard when, in France, that France spends 150 times more on art than the U.S. does, even though France is tiny and America is big. And So that's about cultural confidence, and it's also about encouraging the tourist industry in part. And so there can be, I think, many very civic-minded interventions on the part of in the art world. I don't think one should immediately assume that they're bad at all.
Mentioned Christie's being able to operate auctions independently in China, or in Shanghai. I feel like that came along, that there was some kind of exchange that Christie's did for them. I feel like it had something to do with returning the zodiac heads.
And or the bronze.
The bronze happened. But it was something along the lines of that. Yeah, that, you know, that because there was that exchange, the government then allowed Christie's to independently operate auctions there. Which is not to say that we still don't have a lot of restrictions. We still have a lot of restrictions. Yeah, that was definitely something quite positive for our market. And also for us to be able to promote younger Chinese artists that have very, very specific examples within China.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that no matter where you are, one of the things that you just need to be, that we just need to be cognizant of the fact that when there's any kind of government support for the arts, there will always be some kind of a, you know, often restriction in one way or another. And I'm not talking about specifically about the Chinese government here. I'm even talking about the American government. I mean, we don't have a lot of support for the arts, but we have the NEH, we have the NEA, we have the IMLS. And each one of those institutes, programs supports a particular kinds of projects, and they shy away from other types of projects. And that cannot help but lead to the production of a specific type of project more than other kinds of projects.
And we have to remember that sponsorship by corporations also often mm-hmm. comes with conditions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when a fashion house sponsors a costume institute exhibition,
mm-hmm.
that's not really going to happen unless some of their products are in the exhibition, or some of their past products are in the exhibition. And some private individuals are more thin-skinned than others, too. Some, well, like you were saying, some of the Rockefellers were way more open-minded than others. Abby Aldrich was sort of a miracle of open-mindedness. Wow.
Be able to keep that up despite
her own husband.
Her own husband, yeah. But I think that you know, I mean, there's always going to be this symbiotic relationship between all of these different components and art and artists. And I don't really think that there's a way to get rid of that, but I think we have to be aware of it. And I think that artists who are true to themselves and true to their art will always find a way to be creative and to create great works of art despite what's going on around them, whether it's, you know, political repression, or it's, you know, crazy consumer culture, or whatever. I think that kind of, you know, it's what you were saying, genius is always going to kind of rise through all that muck.
Sometimes it almost feeds on it.
Yeah.
It's really admirable.
Yeah, and your question actually reminds me of a talk I attended during Asian Art Week by Christie's China President Tsai Jingqing. So someone in the audience asked about the entrance of Christie's into China and the like anti-corruption movement that is going on. Like, what are the impacts of the anti-corruption movements have on the art markets, because some people mm-hmm. were suspected to use art works as like a way of money laundering. Yeah. So I think President Tsai said that it was actually good for Christie's, because it came not long after. So it has a shorter history in China's market, and it's from the West. So. Yeah, compare with other institutions.
Yeah, but as you say, it's been going on for thousands of years. I mean, you know, the Athenians were sort of money laundering back around the time of the Acropolis with art.
time constraint, this would be the end of our panel. And if you have any more questions, you can talk to our speakers afterwards, because they can stay for this bit. And thank you so much for giving us such an incredible night, sharing your thoughts.